talk about AI. The world is abuzz right now. We are smack in the middle of an AI revolution. And intelligent chatbots, smart speakers, facial recognition systems, autonomous cars, these are technologies we are using in some way, and it's making our lives better. But what's more interesting to me is the amount of new data these systems are generating, be it volume, velocity, or variety. You add AI and analytics to the mix, and that's pushing enterprises to think of new enterprise digital models. Now, the AI for enterprise narrative is gathering a lot of momentum. According to IDC, over the next 3 years, enterprise AI spend is set to double, and value realization is almost slated to touch $6 trillion. And that too across a whole gamut of industries. Going into adoption a little bit, studies say that some company executives believe that the amount of AI that is being embedded into offerings will go from about 10% to about 60% over the next 5 years. Those are phenomenal numbers, but not without its own challenges. The need for data, the need for data ecosystems is a challenge. Organizational buy-in, technology, processes, people continues to be a challenge. Regulations in industry like banking, pharma, healthcare continue to be a challenge. But in our experience working with enterprises, the biggest challenge is the perception of value realization. That's the burning question in the boardroom. Today, that's what we're going to talk about, the value paradigm of AI. I'm now going to call 4 consulting leaders from Bridgei2i to come on stage and help us have a deeper look. Now, according to the diffusion of innovation theory, value adoption, or adoption in any industry, there are 4 types of industries, 4 types of sectors actually. Innovators, early adopters, early majority, and late majority. I'm now going to ask our experts to take you through each of these sectors and go over how adoption has built up over the years.
Talking about innovators, enterprise technology and e-commerce, it has been the industry which took AI plunge very early, and we have a lot to show in terms of outcome and value. There are about 41% of technology companies which are going to either alter or change to a new business model altogether in next 2 to 3 years. Let's take an example with enterprise industry to understand why, how, and where they have adopted AI technologies. If you look at the enterprise technology use cases, it is spread across their value chain, starting from product development value chain to customer value chain. And not to forget, it is definitely driven by the most fast, efficient, automated, operational, and functional processes. Let me focus on customer experience because everything is connected. Customer experience in these AI initiatives has been really ranked high. If you talk about real-time, personalized recommendation engine, to recommend right product to right customer at right time, at through right channel, everything is getting automated. The customer support system is completely automated using chatbots and virtual assistants. There has been equal amount of effort that is going in defining new and innovative products. Smart appliances is a great example of that. These smart appliances is not only making their life easier, but also creating a lot of data, generating streaming data in case. But having a best-in-class customer experience, tech companies have realized that it's not possible without having an autonomous, efficient, and agile operational and functional processes. Even the robotics as a concept is a futuristic concept. Supply chain is already using it. RPA, robotic process automation, is actually used by technology companies to track, monitor, and manage their inventory within warehouses. We heard a lot about IoT, and the previous session was about IoT, and it has been a buzzword for some time, but with the use of these smart products and appliances, It has become into reality. People have enough data to start analyzing it. Gartner also talks about immersive user experience that will enable digital business processes and, of course, improve customer experiences within technology, enterprise technology companies.
So innovators showed the way, and a few industries came forward recognizing that, adopting AI to make a difference. BFSI, retail, healthcare, the auto sector were some of the leaders in there. Obviously, as you see, some of them are, or most of them, were direct-to-consumer sort of companies. Now, opportunity in AI is huge, right? And in retail itself, the opportunity with AI is expected to be north of $8 billion at a CAGR of 40%. Now, having said that, what these early adopters really did was use technology as a way to make customer interactions and services and goods available to them in a more seamless manner, right? Voice-based product searches. Can I take a video of my car and send it across for my car insurance? Now, these mechanisms were technology-led and generated a lot of data, some of which we had earlier, some were new. Now, with this richness of data and cheaper storage and faster compute available now, being able to mine the data was much more feasible. With this, these enterprises started to pass on the benefit back to the customers, and that really was what made the paradigm shift, right? The idea was being able to pass on that benefit to the customer and give an enhanced customer experience. Rajini talked about personalization, right? When I go to a customer, how do I use some of this information about that customer or customers like him to be able to then say, can I personalize for him? Can I customize for what he needs? And can I contextualize for what he has done with me or otherwise recently? So being able to personalize, customize, contextualize, and make sure that the customer gets what he wants before he asks me for it. Being able to make customer service available at fingertips, chatbots. I don't have to wait on queues. I can get onto intelligent chatbots, and chatbots can solve my customer queries for me seamlessly. Customer satisfaction. You know, there is a lot of talk about customer satisfaction. Can I track customer satisfaction? Can I predict customer satisfaction? Can I stay ahead of the curve and make sure I can better customer satisfaction with a better customer experience for the customer, right? And not just all of this, people talk about omni-channel, not just cross-device. How do I make sure that omni-channel becomes truly omni-channel and translates seamlessly in-store as well? What I show to the customer on the website is that very different from what I behave with him on the store. And what I did on the website, do I use that to be able to evolve myself, update myself on how I interact with the customer in-store? So his in-store customer experience is seamless. So that's for the customer, but for the organization to also say, can I use some of this and AI to drive operational effectiveness as well? Can I use my planning exercise and go granular to say, I will not go out of stock or be eliminate overstock situations and plan significantly better? And do price optimizations at a more granular level and customized level, so that I exactly know how am I spending my budget, which has a constraint, to be able to maximize ROI. Now, doing that, innovation in product becomes important and is a key theme for me to stay ahead of the curve and stay relevant to the customer as well. Since they were early adopters, and I think from the previous presentation, from how Venkat talked about it, what they were able to do really is make sure that technology is an interface to talk to customers, generates data. So I have a data, algorithms, and technology back to data and being able to stitch this whole piece together, being able to make a difference to at the end consumer, and hence a result of that, my own revenue and profitability side of things as well.
So retail, as you just heard, was pretty quick to actually get onto the AI bandwagon. Because retailers, both traditional and online, have always had this huge data advantage. So leveraging that wealth of data and the direct consumer connections they've always had, they were pushing private label brands and brands of their choice. So in some way, that's one of the big reasons why CPG players were actually forced to get onto the AI train. Now, if you look at CPGs today, they're sitting on large amounts of information. There's traditional enterprise data, there's consumer data, especially online behavior, there is partner data, there's even data from sensors and IoT applications. So though a little late to the party, CPG players across the world have started realizing that this huge wealth of data they've got is a strategic asset that needs to be protected, nurtured, and then leveraged for concrete business impact. So using AI and sophisticated analytics techniques, they've actually started trying to generate actionable insights out of this data. Now, when you think about analytics and AI and applications of such techniques, the most obvious one is making predictions. What could be the demand of a new product I'm launching, or what is likely to be the impact of a marketing campaign I'm launching? What are new emerging consumer trends that I need to be aware of? So in that context, these four use cases you see here are among the top four use cases today for CPG. Number one, demand forecasting. So this is demand forecasting for existing and new products across SKUs, across regions. Number two, ROI measurement for marketing spend. How do you identify whether your promotional advertising marketing campaigns are actually having an impact on sales? How do you determine ROI? Number three, optimized store assortments. How do you figure out optimized product assortments to be sold at each individual store? And number four, data-powered sales activation. How do you identify the right points of sale? How do you identify the right retail outlets to activate these applications? And then how do you identify which are the right sales actions to be carried out at the point of sale level? What I'd actually like to draw your attention to here is one out of every four of these use cases today is being implemented already by large CPG companies. So when you look at all of them, the overwhelming focus in CPG is operational efficiencies and growth. But take a look at professional services, and that's a little bit different. Professional services has been driving these large-scale digital transformation initiatives for a while. And when you look at what they've been doing over the past couple of years, you see certain themes. One is, of course, new model development, new business model development. But there's also intelligent automation. There is also talent empowerment. There is also digital agility. What I think about this industry is various different segments in this industry are set to transform in the next decade. Legal, HR, accounting and auditing, consulting. So in a nutshell, when you look at professional services and CPG, which fall into the early majority bracket of the AI adoption curve, the overwhelming thrust has been on transformative growth.
Great. So the last part of the transformation curve that we want to touch upon is the late majority. And talking about late majority, there are two industries that we want to talk about. The first one is oil and gas. Now, if you look at what's been happening in the oil and gas space, for a large period of time, it's been the use of traditional form of analytics, right? When I say traditional form of analytics, usage of statistical models to do a bunch of different things. One, for example, is quality control. So consistently producing good quality products. The second, which they've really been innovators in this space, is basically looking at process optimization. So when you've got the whole oil and gas process, the ability to optimize these processes using mainly first principles models and using statistical models to sort of tune the parameters that make up these equations or first principles models is what the oil and gas industry has seen over the last couple of years. Now, more recently, and Dr. Venkate sort of touched upon this, IoT has been a big bang area in the oil and gas space, right? With the advent of sensor technology, with the advent of localized computing, with the advent of process control, which is the whole actuators and sensors that he touched upon, what has happened is there's been there's been an explosion in the form of data that we can gather from some of these process plans and assets, right? And that's where we're seeing use cases like predictive maintenance starting to get deployed in some form, in some pilots, as well as large-scale implementations. But the question is, are people deriving value out of these implementations within the oil and gas space? The answer is probably going to be no. And the reason for that is because it's not just about implementation of AI or machine learning models, but it's the utilization of some of these insights, which is what we call the trust between these between AI and consumers of AI, right? So that trust is still a gap within the oil and gas space. Now, we do believe that this industry is going to go through transformation over the next couple of years. That gap, that trust between people and AI is going to close. And it's not just going to be about predictive maintenance because of this, but a lot of upstream and downstream analytics use cases. Just think about improving process efficiency like to levels that we've never seen before, for example, or inventory optimization, spare forecasting, etc. So all of these, which is an end-to-end orchestration from process to supply chain, is going to undergo transformation over the next couple of years when we talk about the oil and gas industry. Not just oil and gas, any process industry, as we may call it. The other industry, and that's what you sort of see on the slides here, is the education industry, right? We do see a lot of stalls, a lot of e-learning platforms that have got booths outside. And this industry has been growing rapidly. I think a couple of years back, everybody wanted to start a company in the e-learning space. I'm sure a lot of people still want to do this, right? Now, if you look at the e-learning space, what companies are doing is they're creating a marketplace. It's a marketplace for people to create content and a marketplace for consumers of content to come in and for both of them to collaborate, right? But now, if you compare this to other existing marketplaces, AWS has a booth outside, cloud computing platforms, look at retail, we just talked about retail. Now, these marketplaces have evolved from just being, bringing consumers and sellers together to actually achieving, let's say, operational efficiency, reducing cost, selling more, and so on and so forth, right? Which is where we see even the education space sort of undergo a lot of transformation over the next couple of years. To give an example, if you talk about product innovation, I think there's a lot of capacity for things like smart content to come in. At the end of the day, we've got an objective. We want our consumers to be happy. We want our consumers to learn. And for us to do that, we can utilize all of the content that is available to actually design something for each of these individuals who are coming in, users of this content, right? Second, think about personalization. Now, each person who's coming in has got a digital signature. Just like, how we buy things outside, we create digital signatures in retail, merchandise, financial services. Similarly, some of these, the consumers within the education platforms have a digital signature. So just the ability to personalize content, personalize courses, personalize learning in order to achieve a end objective for them is a huge capability that can come into this industry. Not just that, I think operational efficiency is completely forgotten as of now. Right now, it's a game of getting more people onto our platforms. But over time, I think there's space for not just RPA, but even intelligent automation to come in, computer vision, NLP, et cetera, to come in and sort of optimize this process end to end, right? From generation of content, generation of courses, to the very end objective of enabling people to learn. So we do see this industry undergoing transformation over the next couple of years as well. Now, the nice part about being the late majority is people have already run the race for a certain amount of time. So there's a lot of learnings that we can take from all of these industries, not just the kind of models to build, but how do you drive adoption of AI, how do you actually derive value out of AI is something that these industries can utilize. Now, having said that, there are innovators within the late majority space, I think, that are doing fabulous work today. And I'm sure a lot of companies are going to walk the same path as well.
Thank you so much for that. So if you really see, there are some key themes emerging from each of these categories in the adoption curve. So if you see, innovators started early, they saw value, and they started implementing it across the universe. So a lot of pan-enterprise transformation happening in the innovator segment. Early adopters, they learned from the innovators. They figured out we have to focus on AI in a couple of key business outcomes. So you see a lot of that translating to customer experience and operational effectiveness. The early majority, they were pushed into a corner because of the industries that were already adopting AI. So they said, we have to find pockets of growth. And therefore, a lot of AI investments in sectors like CPG is going into growth. And finally, late majority learned from all of these people and said, maybe it's time for me to innovate, otherwise I'm going to perish. And therefore, a lot of the investment happening in AI. So just to summarize, what did we learn? Adoption and value are tightly correlated. No matter where you are in this spectrum of innovators to late majority, there is value to be derived in some way or the other. And finally, value is most tangible when adoption is tied to business outcomes. So as you understand the correlation between value and adoption, I think it's very important to have a holistic view of AI. Why do we need to look at consumer AI and enterprise AI in very disparate ways? As consumer AI is generating a lot of data, businesses can leverage that data, build ecosystems on top, and use AI to enable better visibility and control across their business performance metrics. With rich data, algorithms can deliver real-time insights and recommendations down to the last mile, enabling better decision-making. Now, as speed and accuracy increases in decision-making across the enterprise, businesses are able to pass this value back to the consumers, and thereby delivering better customer experience, and also innovation in products, making their lives better. So it's really just one big ecosystem, and there is value to be created across the board, be it information, insight, or impact. That's really AI for the enterprise. So at Bridgei2i, that's what we really do. We obsess about delivering value to our customers, be it building AI and analytics capability, delivering innovation through our AI labs, or solving really complex business problems using a consulting practice. So we are AI for the digital enterprise. Thank you.